All right. So before we get started with the message, just to piggyback on what Liz was talking about with that benefit, this has been such a cool representation of our church and how we can rally behind a family that's going through something tragic. By the way, you are not going to want to miss also the basket raffles that we're going to be doing on Saturday. People all week in the last couple weeks, they've been bringing in different baskets and prizes just to be where you can like buy tickets, put a ticket in, and they'll pull a ticket. Some of the stuff is like unbelievable. Like we have a brand new Weber grill, a nice kayak. We have a big Samsung TV with surround sound. I mean, we're not messing around with the prizes, or I should say you're not messing around with the prizes, because it's only because of the generosity of our church that we're able to pull this off. And we've just been like blown away at how you have responded to this tragedy and what you have been doing for this family. So I just know this will be a tremendous blessing for them, and it could be a blessing for you if you win a TV. So, but by show of hands, I'm really curious, how many of you here enjoy gardening? Any gardeners? All right, a few. How many of you, same thing, show of hands, how many of you are good at it? All right, about half of the people that enjoy it. My wife and I are neither good nor do we enjoy gardening. If there's anything we are good at, it's neglecting any plants that come into our possession and killing them in record time. I saw a newspaper article one time of it was someone leaving a nursery with a plant, and they're holding up the plant saying, "You will come to my house to die to meet your last days." And I partially relate to that because we will and have killed any plant that we've owned. But I only partially relate to that because we would never leave a nursery. Like, we don't enjoy gardening, so we don't go buy plants. Because not only are we bad at it, we've never really cared for it. We just sold a house in December, and we lived there for 5 years. And over the course of these 5 years, we never spent any time doing landscaping. In fact, the side of the house where there was landscaping at some point, I just went right over with my lawnmower. The front of the house, we just let God take over. Like, it just, I was going to show you a picture off the listing of the house, but it was, like, so embarrassing. I'm like, I'm not showing this. It's just honestly something we never really cared about. And our house that we had sold in December was 300 feet off the road, which means no one saw our landscaping anyway. So that was just more, like, justification for me to just be like, we're not going to spend money or any time doing this. But this in December, like I said, we moved to Akron, and the house that we moved into had some landscaping done, and we actually knew the person that did the landscaping, spent time to do the plants and the mulch and all that. And over the summer, he asked me, he says, "Brian, what's going on with your landscaping? Like, there's weeds everywhere, like, all these plants are dying." And it was kind of like an eye-opening thing for me, and it was kind of a turning point. I realized, okay, I need to know how to do this at some point. This is the third house we lived in. Like, I should know how to keep a couple plants alive. So I kind of asked him some questions. Okay, what should I do? Like, there was this one plant. I wasn't sure if it was a plant or just a weed. It turns out it was a plant. It was just dead. And he just told me, like, you need to water the plants. So I put it in my phone every 3 days. I've been watering the plants. And I haven't missed a day since. But this was a turning point for me because I wanted to do a better job with it. But here's what I know for sure about gardening, and it's not a whole lot, but if left to chance, your garden will turn into a mess, and you will grow things that you did not intend to grow. If you leave it to chance, it will become a mess, and you'll grow things that you did not intend to grow. It's called entropy. Things naturally head into a direction of chaos, disorder, and randomness. Gardening takes a little bit of an effort, a little bit of intention, but the results can actually be really beautiful. The results can be amazing if you put the time and the intention into it. And there's this passage in the scriptures that I want to look at today that uses a gardening metaphor that I think is really helpful in understanding the process in which we can grow or cultivate joy in our lives. Liz had mentioned we're in the third week of our series, LOL, and one of the things that we've been talking about is that happiness is an external thing. Happiness is often dependent on our circumstances, what's going on around us, maybe our work, maybe what's going on in our home, where joy is an internal thing, and it's completely independent of our circumstances. Joy is often based on the perspective in which we look at our circumstances. So we can be going through a horrible week and have joy still in our lives. And today we're going to talk about how do we get there? How do we grow joy in our lives? So the passage of scripture I want to look at, it's an extremely popular and well-known passage. It's written by a guy named Paul. Paul, just to give you a little bit of background, because I think it's really interesting. Paul was someone who hated Christians. He was a very wealthy and a very powerful man who went around persecuting Christians. He would arrest them, he would kill them, he would stone them. He would go around and arrest them until he had an experience with the risen Jesus that was so convincing to him. It was so like groundbreaking to him that he left everything he had to become a follower of Jesus. He went on to write half of the New Testament. He planted churches all around the Mediterranean rim. And he became like this Christian, this person who was sold out for the mission of Christ. And one of the churches that he planted was in Galatia. And he writes this letter to the church of Galatia. You could follow along in Galatians 5, very well-known scripture. Paul says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. But by the fruit of the Spirit, he means the evidence in our lives are these things. And against such things there is no law, meaning that if these things are evident in our lives, we don't need any worldly law to govern our lives in order to please God. This is the goal that we should be shooting for. And this is why I think it's important to understand, or what is important to understand about this passage is the fact that Paul was very intentional with this word right here, this word fruits. In fact, if all he meant was the evidence of the Spirit is these things, he probably would have used evidence, but he uses the word fruit for a reason. And one of those reasons I think is, you could fill this in if you're taking notes, is because fruit does not just appear. Fruit grows. And I think knowing this is important because it is a reminder that this isn't going to happen overnight. I've never met someone who made a decision to follow Jesus and invited Jesus into their heart, and when they said amen, all those things are evident in their lives. It's a process of growth. It's something that it starts with a seed being planted, and it starts with taking care of that plant, and over time, things will begin to grow in our lives. The goal is not for this to all be evident overnight. The goal is for where I am a year from now to have a little bit of growth between now and next year. If we can do that, that is what Paul is talking about. So it is a process of growth. And I think another reason Paul used this word is because the outside world is attracted to fruit. The outside world is attracted to fruit. I mentioned our previous home earlier with our lack of landscaping. And although I didn't put any effort into the landscaping whatsoever, when we moved in, one of the things that we wanted to do was we wanted to clean up the yard. The house was on 7 acres, and there were some paths, nice paths that went through the woods, and they were kind of a mess when we moved in. There was a dead pine tree and some like old bushes like in the back that just were never taken care of, and I could care less around the house, but I wanted like to be able to walk down the paths. I want to take my dog for a walk and all that kind of stuff. So over the course of a couple years when we first moved in, we were cleaning up these things, and one of the things I wanted to clean up was this plant that was kind of next to the house. It was maybe 5 feet high, 10 feet wide, and it was just an eyesore. We had no idea what it was. It was just a really ugly plant, and the intention was to remove it. But a couple weeks later, I walked by, and I noticed on this plant there were thousands of Concord grapes. And everything changed for me because I love grapes. That's my favorite fruit, like my favorite snack. And this plant, just by seeing the grapes, it went from an eyesore and a waste of space to something beautiful, this beautiful fruit-bearing vine. This was now one of my favorite features of the house. And all that changed was the plant went from something with leaves and branches to something that had fruits. And what's interesting is it was still a mess, but it was beautiful because of the fruit. It served a purpose because of the fruit. And the same thing can be true with our lives. In case you didn't know, in our lives, people aren't attracted to the branches in our life, meaning our knowledge doesn't attract people. Our arguments don't attract people. Our judgments or our politics or even our convictions don't attract people to Jesus. Even on a church level, our lights and our technology and maybe even the coffee and the donuts don't necessarily attract people. What will attract people? Our fruits. Jesus himself, he backed up this line of thinking in the Gospel of John. When he talked about one of the fruits of the Spirit, he said, "A new command I give you, love one another. As I've loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." And like I said, love is one of the fruits of the Spirit. So back to joy for a moment. Have you ever met a crabby, unpleasant, unhappy, unjoyful Christian? Right? Have you ever wanted Jesus to do in your life what Jesus did in their life? No. Have you ever wanted to go to church with that person or spend time with that person? Probably not. But someone who is filled with joy, someone who could be going through a hardship in their life, yet they still have this attitude and the spirit of joy, we're attracted to that type of person. Those type of people are often magnetic to us. And here's what I know about Jesus, is that Jesus cares about those who are far from him. Jesus cares about those who have never experienced real love in their life. And one of the most effective ways to reach people for Jesus is through a relationship. And we're not going to be effective with relationships unless we have attributes in our lives that attract people. Unless we have fruit, leaves, those things I mentioned, those can be helpful maybe, but they don't even come close to comparing to fruit in our lives, what they can do for us and what they can do for others. And this is why this is so vital, because the world has fruit too. The world's fruit is anything that tries to tempt and to draw people away from what God wants for them. And the world's fruit can look really good. In fact, it can taste really good, but it does not lead to lasting satisfaction. The world's fruit can often lead to happiness, but it very rarely leads to joy. So an application question for us, for those of us with a relationship with Jesus, is our life producing enough fruit to attract the world to us in order to attract the world to Jesus? Do people ask us, what's different about you? Why do you have this joy in your life? Like, what is it about you? What do you have that I don't have? And then specifically today, is your life producing enough joy to attract people to Jesus? And then why or why not? So fruit does not appear, it grows. Fruit is attractive. We also have to understand this, that producing fruit requires a few ingredients. First ingredient is this, you could fill this in, is that fruit needs the right soil. Fruit needs the right soil. Are there any coffee fans here today? Anyone want like another cup of coffee before we continue? Maybe. Now when it comes to coffee, I'll be honest, I used to not care at all where my coffee came from, what kind of coffee it was, because I would dump some French vanilla creamer in, two or three sugars, and I would add the coffee to my cream and sugar. But lately, I've been trying to eat healthier, and one of the things that I made a change to was I stopped drinking cream and sugar in my coffee, and I just started drinking black coffee, and that has led to a much greater appreciation for a good cup of coffee. It is worth the little bit extra money to buy a quality cup or quality bag of coffee beans. It is worth the extra couple minutes to use the French press over your regular coffee maker. And if you ever go to a coffee shop that has a pour over, spend the extra dollar or $2 for the pour over cup of coffee. It is worth it. But I do think that sometimes it's taken too far. For example, I was on the Starbucks website looking at different coffee beans that they sell, and I'm not like a huge Starbucks fan, but they do make some good coffee beans. And I came across, like, if you click on any of their coffees, they'll have a description of their coffee. And I clicked on one, and it made me think, okay, this might be a little bit too far. So I'll read the description that they have on the website for the Costa Rican Latin American blend. This coffee, a paradise of stunning beaches, cascading waterfalls, and lush forests, Costa Rica is rich in biodiversity and recognized for cultivating high-quality coffees that flourish on the fertile, I love this, volcanic slopes. And then to balance the vibrant notes and accentuate the brightness Costa Rican coffees contribute, they blended in beans from Latin America, creating this distinctly elegant cup with a soft lemony sweetness and a smooth cocoa texture. Suggested food pairings, lemon loaf, chocolate-covered fruit, or milk chocolate. That sounds pretty good right about now. But it does seem a little extreme. What I do believe, however, is that the soil in which the coffee beans grow absolutely matters. What's kind of interesting is if you look into how coffee beans are grown, they can only be grown in certain climates and in certain soils. They are grown in tropical climates and often mountainous terrains. But what's interesting is cheap coffee, those coffee companies will compromise by planting the coffee beans on flatter terrains where machinery can actually go pick the coffee beans. But the more expensive and the more quality ones they're grown on the mountains, or in this case, the volcanoes, where you can only pick them by hand. So the cheap coffee companies, they'll compromise the flavor in order to reduce the cost. I thought that was really interesting. The bottom line is that the soil matters to coffee. So to use this analogy of soil, we plant ourselves in life too. Every single one of us, when maybe we bought a house or we moved into an apartment, we considered things like the neighborhood. We consider things like the school district. We consider things like maybe if you have kids, you want to live on a slower speed limit street. We all think about the things where we plant ourselves in life, but I would encourage you to think about where you plant yourself spiritually as well. I mean, you could say it this way, that what we are planted in determines what we become. Where we decide to dedicate and put our roots down in will determine the things that we care about, the things that we think about, the things that we value. And I want to ensure you, at One Church, we work our tails off to produce good soil for you. We work hard to provide good spiritual nutrients and give you tools. And Liz is going to talk about growth groups in just a moment, but that is one of the things that we work hard on, to provide these groups where you can be surrounded by a community of other believers, where you can grow together in your walk with God. But here's the thing. The church or the soil can only do so much. Rich soil will be useless unless you plant yourselves, and you plant yourselves deep. And by the way, it doesn't have to be One Church. I say it all the time. We would be honored if you chose this to be your church home, but there are a lot of great churches in Western New York that are doing a lot of amazing things. We would love it if it was here, but there's a lot of other places. It doesn't matter to us. In fact, we care a lot more about the name on the front of the jersey than the name of the back of the jersey. Like, we are all one church, and we are one representation of that. So if you find another place is maybe closer to home, maybe that it just works out better for you, we'll pray for you, we'll bless you. Like, that is great. We just care that you are planted somewhere with rich and good nutrients. So if you want to grow the fruit of the Spirit, I'm just convinced that it's possible to do it without a community of believers, but it is very difficult, and we were never intended to do it that way. So are you planted in good soil? The second thing we need, the second ingredient is this, is that fruit needs the sun. Now, real fruit needs the sun, S-U-N. This is S-O-N, because we believe that if we're going to grow and cultivate fruit in our lives, we need the Son of God. We need Jesus. So there is this one plant in Danielle and our lives that we have done a pretty good job at keeping alive. Just one. It's the orchid. I don't know if you've ever had an orchid, but it is the easiest plant to keep alive, because you could just like put it in a room with windows that you keep the curtains open. You put a couple ice cubes in it once a week, and it just like it stays alive. Like, no work required whatsoever. But imagine if we, for 6 days a week, if we kept that plant in our basement, and then one day a week we brought it upstairs and we put it in the indirect sunlight that it's supposed to get, and then after that day we brought it back to the basement for another 6 days, what would happen? That plant would die almost instantly. See, I've been guilty of doing this spiritually in my life. There have been seasons that I've completely relied on Sundays to grow spiritually. And maybe you're the exception, but I've never been able to do that. I've never been able to survive spiritually and to grow spiritually on just on Sundays. Sunday's not enough for me. But the good news is that it has never been easier in the history of humanity to connect with Jesus throughout the week. You could listen to podcasts, you could listen to worship music, you could listen to any preacher on the planet pretty much in the device on your phone, like in your pocket, in your phone, so easily. However, I'm 100% convinced that this, and you could fill this in, the best way to understand the Son of God is through the Word of God. Again, there are hundreds of tools, infinite ways to connect with Jesus, but I'm 100% convinced that the best way to understand the Son of God, Jesus, is through the Word of God, our Bible. So a couple simple ways to do that. One is, and we've been talking about it for a few weeks, but right on the back shelf in the foyer, there's these little devotionals called Our Daily Bread. Every single day, there's just a little thing that you can read with some scripture, and it has a little reading plan where this day you would read three different chapters. It's a great way to get started in reading your Bible. Another way you could do that is, this is what I do, I use the YouVersion Bible app. It's just a free app on the phone where you could access any translation of the Bible. There are thousands of reading plans that you can do, and if you want to go through the Bible in an entire year, you could do that. You could do a five-day plan, three-day, like you could do whatever type of reading plan you want. Or you could just get an old-fashioned paper Bible, a highlighter, a notebook, and you could just start reading. Maybe every day you just read three chapters out of the Bible. And by the way, if you don't have a Bible, there's ones in the seat backs in front of you or the underneath the seat in front of you. You could grab that. You could take that home if you want to. It's yours if you want it. But I'm just saying there are so many ways to connect with God through the Word of God. In fact, I want to pose a challenge for you, for every single person here. And maybe this is already a habit for you, but if it's not, maybe for the next 21 days, every day you just read one chapter of the Bible and see what happens. See if you can grow closer to God. See if you can grow closer to the heart of God. In fact, if you do this for 21 days and you don't grow closer to Jesus, Pastor Rick will buy you a bag of the volcanic coffee, all right? He doesn't know that yet, but he will buy you some volcano coffee. So we need soil, we need the sun, and then, of course, to grow anything, fruit needs water. Fruit needs water. So I told you about the guy who did our landscaping when we moved in, and he asked me the questions like, Brian, what's going on with your landscaping? Well, ever since that conversation, again, I've been faithfully watering the plants every 3 days, but before I started doing that, I just asked him, how often should I water them, but also, how much water should I give them? Should I, just sprinkle them with water? Should I drench them with water? How should I do it? And he kind of encouraged me. He said, Brian, they're, dead right now, so soak them for a while. He said, soak them for a while. He wanted me to immerse the plants in water. See, the truth is, I believe that we soak our lives in something, whether we think about it or not. For example, I'll tell you what I soaked my life in just this past week. I soaked my life in 4 NFL football games, about 5 hours of sport talk radio, and I have 3 fantasy football teams, so I was reading different things, and just I was soaking my life in the things of the NFL. And what this led to all week, I thought more about the NFL than I ever wanted to think ever. And it kind of grossed me out, how much I was thinking about football and these things. And the truth is, again, we all soak in things all the time. We soak our minds in things like TV or Netflix or music, podcasts, or social media. And what we soak our minds in tends to determine our attitude. It tends to determine where our thoughts are. Again, I was thinking about football all week, so that's what I was thinking about all week, but we all soak our minds into something. And just a side note, if you want 2 real easy ways to add joy to your life, 2 things I'll tell you to do. 1 is cut back on social media. I mean, there's been studies after studies after studies showing that a lot of social media usage has led to depression, anxiety, and a lack of satisfaction with our lives. That will obviously rob us of joy. But the other thing, and maybe you haven't thought about this, but cut back on national news stations. There's been studies after studies showing that these can lead to fear. Overuse of them. Use is okay, but overuse of them can lead to fear. That will absolutely rob us of joy. Now, are these things bad things in and of themselves? No. TV is great. Netflix is great. I love social media. It helps me to connect with friends and keep track of people who are like far away but are still close to me. There's a lot of upsides to these things. I love podcasts and Netflix. But if we soak in them too much, it will absolutely control our attitude, our thought life. It will have control of our minds. Now, I want to encourage you with something, and this is the last fill-in for today. The big idea of this message is that the one thing that can change everything is the presence of God. Soaking your mind in the presence of God. So really practical, this is how I do it. I will turn everything else off, and I will just listen to worship music. I'll go on Spotify, or you could go to YouTube, whatever you want, buy a CD, and just put in worship music. If that's new to you, I'll just encourage you, just YouTube Hillsong, and just listen to the music that comes out. And the reason I do this is because, and two times I do this most, one, right before I fall asleep, and as I'm driving places. And I do this for the purpose of, I want to saturate my mind with worship. I want to saturate with my mind with the things of God, and I want to dwell on the words and think about the words. And I'm telling you what this has done for me is when I arrive at my destination, when I'm driving, or when I'm falling asleep, my mind is thinking about Jesus. My mind is just completely focused on the things of God. So that's a real practical thing that you can do. And by the way, Sundays, the music portion of our service is not the warm-up to the message. You know that, right? That is maybe even more important than anything we will say, because it is a chance for us as a church to soak in the presence of God together as a community. But just like with our Bible, we don't have to wait until Sundays. We could do this every single day. And this is, by the way, what we want to establish with our family. If you're new to One Church or just visiting today, my wife and I recently had a newborn baby. Her name is Eliana, and she just turned 3 months yesterday. By the way, yesterday, she had her first, full laugh that we've ever heard. We heard, a half laugh a couple weeks ago, but this was the first time, and I just set her down to change her, and I'm getting the diaper, and she just has this full laugh, and it was the most beautiful thing ever. I think she was laughing at what I was going to have to deal with a couple seconds later with that diaper. But one of the things that we've been working really hard to do is to establish routines with her. And we've been focusing on sleeping routines because we like any parent, we want her to be able to sleep throughout the night. And people ask all the time, how is she sleeping? And people get really ticked off with my answer because she's sleeping 8 to 10 hours every single night since she was 3 weeks old. I don't care if you're mad at that because it is awesome as the father. So we've been doing these sleeping routines, and Danielle added something to Ellie's bedtime routine just this past week. She told me that she wanted to add this. So this is what her routine looks like every single night. We bathe her. We do that every other day. We change her. We put her pajamas on, we feed her, we swaddle her, and then the last thing we do is we sing her Jesus Loves Me. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. See, we believe with all of our hearts that the most important thing we do on this planet is to raise our daughter to know the love of Jesus. You know, one day she will become an adult and she'll move out of the house and she'll be able to choose her own path in life, but you better be darn sure that we will do everything in our power to expose her to the love of Jesus. And one of the ways that we've just chosen to do that is to saturate, to soak our household in the presence of God. So we're going to play worship music a lot. We're going to sing her these songs. We're going to read her the Bible out loud. We're going to pray for her out loud because we want her to know that she will always be soaked in the prayers of her mom and her dad. We can do this for our families and we can do this for ourselves as well. The only thing that can change everything is the presence of God. If you want to grow joy in your life, if you want to grow joy in your home, if you want to watch the fruit of the Spirit take roots and to grow over time, if you want your joy to be not based on your circumstances, but based on your perspective, it may start for you by soaking in the presence of God, getting our minds right, being transformed by the renewing of our minds. That may be where it starts for you. And here's the thing to remember before we close, is that the fruit that grows in our life is 100% dependent on the choices that we make. We choose to plant ourselves in soil, and we choose that what that soil is. We choose whether or not we're going to expose it to the sun, if we're going to spend time with Jesus, and we choose what we soak our minds in. So my encouragement to you is to do the things that we talked about. Spend some time reading the Word of God. Spend some time just soaking in the presence of God, listening, turning everything else off, and soaking in worship, soaking in something that changes the way that you think. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you so much for the things that Paul teaches, that we thank you that this fruit that you want us to grow, God, that it's a process, that you don't expect us to just have these things overnight. You don't expect us to have it all figured out. All you want for us, Lord, is to take another step in the right direction. So God, we ask that you would just speak to us in this moment. Show us what we need to do in order to produce better fruit in our lives. God, we thank you for your Son. We thank you for everything you are, everything good in our world. God, we thank you. We pray this in your name. Amen.